the same.
They are just taking advantage of the traffic and the you know, accessibility.
That's what we call mobile commerce.
I like it.
Mobile business people.
I'm nervous.
So they go into the supermarket to grab your items at the wholesale price and they retail in the street.
Yeah.
So you can actually move your car from your home and do shopping in the street and get home and start preparing whatever you want to prepare.
Right.
So if you have salt,
a lot easier.
Maybe salt I've not seen being sold in the street.
In another context, it's like drive through, you know, you want it quick, fast. So you grab stuff which you know, you can always buy. Yeah.
We'll be right back.
When you came, you have made friends too. Most of those little kids, so you can give one to them too.
Yes. You don't have to feel bad about the person that you select, because you can't solve all these problems.
Yeah, don't feel bad.
You don't have 1,500 t-shirts. So they're used to receiving something, and other people don't always get something. Every leaf on a tree doesn't bloom. Some do, but not all of them. So someone gets something this time, someone else gets something next time. But they're not going to fight and be all upset and depressed because they didn't get a t-shirt. So you see these calf shirts they have on. We brought those shirts here too. But not everybody has one.
And again, before our lead forgot to come, I want to just add my voice to our student for just to thank Nana. For the special hospitality that you have extended to us. We have enjoyed this place. And I was sharing with a student that I can't remember the last time that I experienced sleeping, even though we all grew up in a village here in Ghana. It's been an enriching experience for me as well, a great learning experience. So. Again, thank you for everything you've done for us. Through you, we want to extend our appreciation to the elders and the members of the village. So, again, we're very grateful for everything you've done for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I would like to, and the chief, thank you for welcoming me back to your village and allowing me to be part of this celebration. I hope to come back and enjoy this again and appreciate it. And for the students, you have impacted me as well. That I have, in my own heart, have decided that I don't have any children, that you are my children. And I am your other Baba, your New York Baba. And that if there's anything that you need that I can help with, let me know. I'll make sure that Okantah has all my contact information, and that if you need me, you know how to contact me by email or a phone or a letter. I am your Baba in New York, and I'll be there to help you whenever you need me. Thank you.
Thank you. You've done what you wanted to do?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
Not yet.
I want to talk about Megan's thing too.
Pardon?
I want to mention Megan's thing too.
You want to do that now?
Yeah, we can do that. What were you doing before?
This is heavy, so you can put it down.
I speak to people all of the time, but right now my emotions are in my throat. To Nana Eduakwa, to the elders of the village, to the Queen Mother of the village, to Nana Kwa Kwamina. There are no words that I could say that would express my love for you, my respect for all of you, each of you. We have talked about doing this for years. Chief Eduakwa performed a traditional naming ceremony in my house for my grandson, so that I have learned so much. These are also my children. Baba Yao, Kwesi, Sekou, Kwame Felix, these are my brothers. I want to thank you for welcoming us to the village. I want to thank you for making us feel at home. I want to thank you for giving us the feeling that we do not want to leave. And on behalf of all of us, and on behalf of the Department of Pan-African Studies at Kent State University, and on behalf of Black United Students at Kent State University, because without Black United Students, there would be no Department of Pan-African Studies. We would like to give you these t-shirts for the Village Council. We have two t-shirts for Brother Kofi and our driver. These young people have also brought other clothes that could be given out to people here in the village as you see fit. You have poured libations for us to see that we would be guided and protected on this journey. So we have also brought drink that we also want to give to you to show our appreciation for everything that you have done for us. And as I said last summer, as we sat right here and you made us a part of the village, I will be back again and we will bring more students, because our students need to experience this. There is only so much that we can teach them in the classroom. There is only so much that they can watch on video. There is nothing that would give them what they found in this experience. So on behalf of all of us, we thank you so, so much.
Thank you.
Yes. Glad to see you here.
No.
This is something good. So those are the two for the drivers and Kofi.
Okay.
And these are for the council.
Council. Okay. But when you say enter A. All right. Thank you very much.
Year after the freedom, cause we didn't have the sense to know we was free. We stayed there a year after the freedom, cause we didn't have the sense to know we was free. They told her, oh yes, they told her. Them say you must tell your children's children, told her keep our story alive. Slavery days did not destroy them. She stood with them. We have survived. Them say you must tell your children's children. Told her keep our story alive. Slavery days did not destroy I and I. She stood with them. We have survived.
From this area, our spirits are also being called back home through this area.
How did this that history that you just described, how did that affect the Akan, the Asantehene?
Well, you find that because this was the entry point of the Europeans, they made contact initially through this cape. You know, that Cape Coast, you know, took on its name because this is a place conducive for the ships landing and for them entering into Africa. And you find that after some period, it was realized that in the interior, there was a leakage of white people coming on the continent. Mm-hmm. And people wanted to find out where they're coming from. They felt like they're coming from this area down here, you know, that they were penetrating the land basically through Cape Coast and Elmina. And so then they realized through some successive generations that in this area, which we call the Fanti territory, most of the Fanti, a member of the Akan group, you know, they were the ones engaged with the Europeans first. Because of that engagement, eventually they became somewhat of middlemen in trade. Of course, the horrible point of that also became, you know, human cargo. But at first it was legitimate trade in gold, ivory, other, you know, sources that, you know, degenerated into human trade. So the Ashanti, as legend has it, wanted to come down here and take command of the coast so they can control, you know, the Europeans from, you know, infiltrating the interior, but at the same token began to control the trade that was going on directly. So in that respect, the British also felt that, who had more or less like a warlike nature, and they had a serious problem with trying to control, wanted to basically take the Ashanti area as they move north and move interior, because the Ashanti are more forest-like, more interior. So that started the period and the era of the Ashanti-British Wars. And then starting the period of the Ashanti-British Wars, part of that episode when the British began to get the upper hand was they captured the Asantehene. When they captured the Asantehene, they brought them back down here to the Elmina Fort. There's even a room there called the Prempe Room. Because the Asantehene Prempe was the one, the Asantehene at that time, and he was kept in that room along with his family. And the Asante people being so devoted to their king and to their culture and to their heritage, many of the Asante people ended up following their king down here just to be close to him, even though he was incarcerated. And of course, that era also initiated the era, the famous era of Ya Asantewa, who was the famous queen mother, who felt that while the men were sitting around grieving and mourning the capture of their king, they should have been, you know, arming themselves to go down to rescue him and to continue to engage in the warfare with the British until they got their king back. So that started the period of the Ya Asantewa Wars with the British. So what ended up happening was, you find that Elmina, unlike a lot of the other, you know, Fanti territory, Elmina has a large population of Ashanti that have now amalgamated and been a part of, you know, the Elmina community down here. Family, you know, integrated. They never went back, to Ashanti territory, and they become a part of the family, the legacy, you know, of the Elmina township and the Elmina people.
Okay. So, from what you told me moments ago, independence came in 1957?
Yes.
And describe that scenario.
Well, what you had was a continued, you had the beginning of the agitation of independence movement. This thing started as early back as the British, you know, British rule in the area. What I mean by that is that the British rule came by subtly. You can imagine that this language of the white man was not fully understood by the Africans, whether spoken or written. And there was an agreement that was made in the early days, you know, what they called the Bond of 1844. And that Bond of 1844 was to invite British law to come in as a reference point to help govern the land. But the British had in their mind that was they had agreed that the British would rule the land through their law. But that wasn't quite the understanding of the Fantis who had made that agreement, entered into that agreement. So there got to be, you know, a discrepancy around what the interpretation of that law meant. And of course the British enforced their interpretation, meaning that we are ruling the land, and that the land is now under British rule and under the Queen, or under the King, you know, under the Queen of England, under the Royal Throne of England. So that began part of the British dominance of the Gold Coast, and even this area being labeled the Gold Coast. And so you find that because that wasn't all the time agreed, there's always been an agitation around the British dominating this area. And then so you find that there was another very important scenario that came up in the history of here, which was called the Aboriginals Rights Society. The Aboriginals Rights Society was another group of indigenous Fanti men and women who had become educated in English law, were fully literate, and they began to argue the fact that they never ever, and their ancestors never ever, through the bond of 1844 or anything else, surrendered the rights of the land, that they were the original people of the land, and they were the original owners of the land. And although they might have been in partnership with the British, and the British were sharing in the governance of the land, they were not the owners of the land. That was a very important document, agreement, and society. They even sent emissaries to England, to the Queen, to negotiate that treaties. And so it was based on that they'd always been in agitation for independence, but it was like subtle. So that you find that after World War II, and they realized that the European nations were weakened through World War II, that agitation escalated. So you have the what they call the political party of the UGCC, you know, the Ghana Convention People's Party. They started to agitate through legal means for the freedom and independence of Ghana. But it seemed that it was stagnated, you know, just a matter of just the legal argument, legal agitation, so that they needed to find some way to have this movement take on more teeth. So this is when the idea that Kwame Nkrumah was identified as being a homeborn son in the diaspora, who actually had made serious contacts in the Pan-African world. And that one of his colleagues who knew him in London, or met him in London, Aku Ajay, informed his other colleagues that we have a Ghanaian, it wasn't called Ghanaian then, we have a brother, a Gold Coaster, you know, in the diaspora, who's very active, you know, very knowledgeable and very well respected in the Pan-African community. And maybe we can invite him down to be a part of our organization, and he can help us push this movement forward for independence. So actually they paid for his way and sent for him to come down here. A lot of people don't talk about the fact that Kwame Nkrumah was reluctant to come down because he felt that the movement was too bourgeoisie and too conservative, and he didn't want to come back down. But he was convinced to come back down by W.D. Du Bois and some of the other diasporans that, no, if you come back down and you become a part of that organization and you become a part of the independent movement and gain independence for the Gold Coast, all of us can have a voice then on the international stage, because Ghana would be independent and have a presence and membership in the UN. And we can use that to help fight to free all of Africa. And we would not leave you alone, we will assist you. So with all of that, he decided to take up that offer and come back down here, and he took up the position of General Secretary of the political party. And through that, he began to organize nationally, going to the grassroots people to organize for freedom and independence from British rule. And there was an incident that helped to bring about, you know, the kind of emotional impact that needed to go with a movement like that. And that incident was, there was a march by some of the veterans who had not received their pay from the British, who had fought in World War II. And they decided it was unfair, they weren't receiving their pension. So they decided to march on the governor's quarters in Accra, and to protest not receiving their pension after having been veterans and put their lives on the line. And in order to try to control that protest, it resulted in the British opening up fire on the veterans who had fought, you know, for them. And three of them were killed. And that sent a populist uprising over the shooting death by policemen of those three veterans. And that gave more impetus to people listening to Kwame Nkrumah's voice. And so they felt that they used that opportunity to agitate more for freedom. Eventually Kwame Nkrumah and the leaders of their party were arrested, put in jail, and then the people also supported him in jail. The British agreed to having, you know, a referendum on whether or not, you know, they should consider Ghana to be an independent state, and they should be get their independence in stages. So they did that, and Kwame Nkrumah was voted as the prime minister while he was in jail. And then they came out of that, and ended up having a discrepancy with the party about Kwame Nkrumah's role and how he got them in trouble and got them thrown in jail. So they actually suspended him from the party. And when they suspended him from the party, a lot of the young people in the party, grassroots people, decided that you don't need to seek readmittance back into that party, start your own party. So Kwame Nkrumah started his own party called the CPP, Convention People's Party. And with that, the rest is history. Kwame Nkrumah took that party, it grew, it swelled throughout Ghana. They fought for independence from the British. They eventually gained their independence from the British in 1957. And, you know, as Kwame Nkrumah said then, I'm not finished with this. You know, the independence of Ghana is meaningless without the total independence of the whole African continent. By then, he had his eyes set that Africa should be free, not just this little small territory. And of course, you know, none of the colonial powers were happy with that. They thought they'd give him that little corner, he'd be satisfied and mind your business. But he actually, you know, was infectious that once people realized that the Gold Coast could be free and get their independence, other African nations and territories, you know, began to fight for their freedom. Because at that famous 1945 Fifth Pan-African Congress, you had personalities like Nnamdi Azikiwe of Nigeria, you had Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya, you had delegates from South Africa. I mean, you had a number of delegates there. So naturally, they were looking at Ghana, you know, as the leader and the example that whatever could happen in Ghana, the whole African world was looking at that. So when Ghana had successfully, you know, gained her independence from the British, of course, it only took 3 years, 1960, and 1960 alone, 30 African nations gained their independence in 1960 alone, just from the example of what Kwame Nkrumah and Ghana had done, you know, during that era and during that period. And also being from the U.S., you know what that period represented in the U.S. in terms of the kind of dynamics that was going on in the 60s, you know, for the black man to rise up for his natural God-given rights, you know, of equality and human rights globally. So that is a, you know, very brief and, you know, missing the fine point, you know, footnote detail of what kind of helped lead up to the 1957 independence movement. But that is, you know, a very short narrative of some of the dynamics that took place.
What can you say in terms of them taking the ancient name Ghana?
Well, I think that right now in Ghana there is some debate going on. I don't want to say controversy, but it's debate going on about who thought of that name first. One of the historians of Ghana, who was also a political activist, David Dankwa, or Kwame Nkrumah. The fact of the matter is, it was during Kwame Nkrumah's prime ministry that he put the bill before the parliament of changing the Ghana's name from the Gold Coast to Ghana. Now, who originally thought of that or came up with that historically is what's being debated, you know, whether Kwame Nkrumah did or whether J.P. Dankwa did. But the idea was that Ghana should not being independent and being free, it should not carry the shackles of colonialism into a new era. And that Ghanaians should be reminded that it's not her experience nor contact with the white man and colonial powers that gave them their first contact with the arts and sciences of civilization, but that we come from a people who have a high history of being a civilized people and made so many contributions to civilization. So Ghana, being one of those brilliant and one of the level kingdoms that, you know, most of the people from Ghana had come from, were their ancestors, that they would name Ghana after one of the great, you know, flourishing kingdoms that were the West African kingdoms that existed here in West Africa before the white man came, and to give Ghanaian people back their dignity, that hoping that that name would also cause them to research, you know, themselves, you know, who was Ghana, where was Ghana, you know, who were the people of Ghana. And that would bring a source of dignity rather than carrying the label, you know, of colonialism into a new era.
Okay, so.
Egypt, Egypt, Ophelia, Egypt. She kept our story alive. She kept our story alive. Talking about how it's
free coming out of that old tree trunk, you know, because Africa is, we're going to put this back together. One village at a time, one person-to-person relationship at a time. And so this is special. This was part of what we wanted to do last night. Nana had bought a bottle of schnapps to pour libation here. But we did that this morning at Elmina. Now Mrs. Egypt settled in our journey's rhythm, time. From Gold Coast villages to Black Bush slums, this black woman, Egypt, she kept our story alive. She kept our story alive. Her name was Egypt.